Abortion from the perspective of the soul. People have asked me, if you believe in reincarnation, why are you against abortion? Many people who believe in reincarnation say that abortion is okay because they think the soul can always come back in another body. Orthodox Hindus and Buddhists and Sikhs believe that abortion is murder. Every sect of Hinduism holds that the soul enters the fetus at the moment of conception. However, in practical life, many adherents of these faiths today believe that abortion is permissible. Here is the rationalization, as Mark Weston explained it in an article in the Washington Post. Hindus, Sikhs, and Buddhists believe in rebirth. So most also believe that an abortion, however regrettable, will not deprive a soul of its one and only chance at life. Many Americans today believe that the soul is not in the body during gestation. Therefore, they erroneously conclude that there is nothing wrong with abortion. I will review the arguments for you and then give you the Ascended Master's teaching on the subject. Some New Agers say a fetus is energy, and energy can't be killed. By that argument, murder would also be condoned, because a person is energy, and energy can't be killed. Well, you can't take the law. Energy is neither created nor destroyed, and apply it to a fetus in the womb. The energy of the fetus has been locked into form by the lords of form, the lords of mind, and the lords of creation. And that form is more than mere energy coalesced. It is child man made in the image and likeness of God. Others say that a woman's freedom of choice should take precedence over the baby's right to life, because the baby will always have another chance. A commonly held belief is that the soul chooses her experiences. I've heard people say that a soul may choose to experience life in the womb for a few months and then return to higher octaves after abortion by her own volition. As a footnote, I would like to tell you that the soul of man or woman is referred to as the feminine potential of being, whereas the spirit, with a lowercase s, which is the essence and animating principle of a person, is considered to be masculine. Therefore, when mentioning the soul, we use the pronoun she and her. When speaking of the spirit, we use the pronoun he and him. So the idea that a soul chooses her experiences denies the law of karma. We certainly do have free will given to us by Almighty God. But you see, we have been exercising that free will for many lifetimes. We have created the karmic circumstances that dictate our return in a specific body at a specific time and place, through specific parents. Thus, we can't just choose to enter life when and where we feel like it. Furthermore, the argument is ludicrous on the face of it. If souls could choose their bodies, wouldn't most people choose to be brilliant, beautiful, and wealthy? Therefore, why isn't everybody brilliant, beautiful, and wealthy? Well, other people put forth the notion that abortion doesn't harm the soul, but gives her an opportunity to return in another body under more ideal circumstances, that is, being wanted instead of unwanted. They say there is no harm to the soul because she hasn't been born yet, as though they were privy to the secrets of creation, of the lords of life and death, they offer the opinion. I don't think a human can harm a soul. Following is the statement of Steven Weinberg, publisher of Ramtha's teachings. This statement is taken from Ramtha's words through J.Z. Knight. Abortion is neither right nor wrong, for God is without judgment. Abortion does not destroy the life of another, for the true nature of every individual is a light essence that has no form and can never be destroyed. Through a body, that light essence has the opportunity to experience the form called matter. Curtailing the developing body within the womb simply removes one potential vehicle for an entity to use to experience humanity. But there are other bodies. Everyone is wholly responsible for his choices, but no woman need ever feel guilt for choosing not to birth a body if she decides that it is in the best interest of her own life experiences not to bear the consequences or responsibility of being in a parental relationship with an embodied spirit-soul entity. Well, I can tell you that Ramtha the Ram is one smart aleck Atlantean discarnate. First of all, since there is right and wrong through the heart of the living Christ in us all, through the Lord our righteousness and through the cosmic Christ, some things are right and some things are wrong in life. And abortion is one of those things that is absolutely wrong. Ramtha makes the statement that God is without judgment. God, as the supreme lawgiver, divides light and darkness, heaven and earth, and right and wrong, and sets laws for us and has given these laws to us through the great lights and avatars and prophets, Christed ones and Buddhas he has sent into our midst. These laws are the very foundations of our Judeo-Christian tradition, and they are the foundations of Eastern thought and a way of life that has existed for tens of thousands of years. That abortion does not destroy the life of another is not correct, for the life is in the body as well as in the soul. He says that the true nature of every individual is a light essence, but he is incorrect that light essence has no form or needs no form, and the light essence is the soul, and the soul can be destroyed. He says it cannot be destroyed. He is not very good at reading the teachings of the great avatars of the ages. For Krishna gives the teaching, never the spirit was born, the spirit shall cease to be never. That spirit is the spirit of the living God with us, the I am that I am. But it is written in scripture that the soul that sinneth, it shall die. The soul is the potential to realize the fullness of the spirit of the living God in form and in formlessness. That option, that opportunity is fraught with decision-making every step of the way. There is right and wrong, and the soul can become lost and become a castaway. And therefore, those who abort life place in jeopardy their own souls as well as the souls of those whom they abort. Through a body, that light essence has the opportunity to experience the form called matter. It is true that souls have the opportunity to experience physical incarnation, but it is not alone for experience. It is for the purposes of balancing karma, serving to set life free, and fulfilling one's divine plan. To curtail the developing body within the womb simply removes one potential vehicle. We are not only removing a potential vehicle when an abortion takes place. We are aborting a life and a destiny that is set by Almighty God. A soul cannot simply hop into another body any time it pleases. There are individuals who allow discarnate entities to hang about them and even to enter them, but this is not an incarnation. This is possession. Everyone is wholly responsible for his choices. This is contradictory to what Ramtha said in the first paragraph that I read to you. If there is no right or wrong, and God does not judge, then how can we be responsible for choices when we cannot tell what choice is right or wrong? Ramtha states that a woman need never feel guilt for choosing not to birth a body. These are the words of fallen angels and devils incarnate, false teachers and false prophets. That is exactly what Ramtha the Ram is, and his purveying of this message concerning abortion, I am certain, has neutralized the conscience of many an individual. Many a woman, I am certain, under the advice of Ramtha, has considered herself to be free to have an abortion. Ramtha does not set responsibility or accountability for the procreative process, for bringing forth life, or being a co-creator with God. His statements are diabolical. They show who and what he is, and let him be exposed before this altar of Almighty God, as well as all others who prattle the same nonsense. Many New Agers who have deluded themselves into believing what is most convenient to believe, that abortion destroys only a vehicle, not a person. This is the root and the fundamental lie of the pro-abortion movement today, which they call pro-choice. Some people even believe that Edgar Cayce condoned abortion because he said that the soul did not necessarily enter the body at conception. During a reading, when asked if the soul entered the child at conception or birth or in between, he replied, "It may at the first moment of breath. It may some hours before birth. It may many hours after birth. That depends upon the condition, the environment surrounding the circumstance." This does not mean that Cayce was saying that it doesn't matter what happens to the body before the soul enters. In the very same reading, Cayce said that one's thoughts and impressions during pregnancy have an effect on the child. Taken in context with all of Cayce's teachings on karma, his statements about the soul cannot be seen as condoning abortion. However, it must be stated for the record that according to the Ascended Masters, the Cayce readings are 65% accurate. Many people who consider themselves in the vanguard of the New Age support a woman's right to have an abortion based on the principle that a woman has free will and the right to control her own body. They may uphold this right even though they wouldn't choose abortion themselves. They say a woman should be able to choose whether or not to have a child. We all agree. But we also must state that she makes her choice before conception, not after. We have better and better birth control methods, and the time to decide whether you are going to participate in the creative process is never after conception. Abortion is not a birth control method. Let's return to the question of when the soul enters the body. Most Orthodox Christians believe that a brand new soul is created for every new embryo. The Catholic Catechism by John A. Harden states, "The Church has never defined the exact moment when the soul is created and infused into the body to form this unique human person. It is assumed that creation of the soul and its infusion take place at the moment of conception. Both the New Age and the Christian view of the soul are wanting. The soul exists before conception. It exists in the beginning with God. The soul exists and comes forth as we are created out of the great white fire ovoid. Twin flames come forth. The manifestation of male and female created by Elohim and the word with Brahman. The souls descend, having cycled through the bands of the causal body, into material form to fulfill their reason for being. Souls are created, and they must complete many life cycles in embodiment before they may return to their point of origin. Therefore, God spake unto the prophet Jeremiah, and he said, "Before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. And before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee, and I ordained thee a prophet unto the nations." God had predestined the soul of Jeremiah, just as he has predestined your soul and the soul of your twin flame to go forth to fulfill a mission of splendor and light and usefulness and creativity in this earth and throughout the spheres of the heavens. We understand that the soul is a continuum, that it exists in the beginning with God and exercising right choices, increasing in the manifestation of light and Christhood. These two souls will one day return home from their journey at last, to bow before the presence of Alpha and Omega and receive the divine approbation. "Well done, thou good and faithful servants. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee rulers over many. This is my beloved son and my beloved daughter, in whom I am well pleased." As I have said, the modern reincarnationists' view that it is okay to abort the body because it's only a body denies that the body is the temple of the living God. The Apostle Paul said it, "What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God? And ye are not your own, for ye are bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Ye are the temple of the living God. As God hath said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people." Paul's point that we must underscore is that ye are not your own. We are not our own, but we are God's. And our souls are bought with a price by the living Savior, Jesus Christ. This means that our bodies are not our own. Our souls are not our own. God has created us and ordained us to bring forth souls made in his image and likeness. Therefore, the freedom to choose to not bring forth the soul that is conceived, that is already in the womb attached to that body from the moment of conception, that choice does not belong to us, because we are not gods. We are sons and daughters of God, and we are obedient to his law of love. He has ordained us to be co-creators with him, not above him. We cannot play God with the soul and the life aborning in our womb. modern reincarnationists, I must say many of whom don't know a thing about the real laws of karma and reincarnation, seem to think that the soul is like a candle on a birthday cake. You just stick it on at the last minute. But this is not the case. The soul and the body are meshed. During gestation, the soul is meshing with the body. God doesn't simply stuff a soul into a body like you stuff a pillow into a pillowcase. The idea that prevails is that the soul and the body are separate. This does not happen to be reality, and it is spoken so easily and lightly by those who truly do not understand the great mysteries of the Lord and Savior. The soul and the body are in the process of becoming one. As the child grows in grace and waxes strong in the Lord, the Christ also descends into that temple, increment by increment, year by year. This integration of the soul with the body and of the soul with her Lord, the Holy Christ Self, takes place from the moment of conception up to and throughout adulthood. Each one of us has a soul or solar awareness, a solar consciousness. Our soul is like a correspondent of the sun that we see in the heavens. Our awareness is spherical, and it is a continuing awareness from the hour of our point of origin, going out from the great central sun, unto our return. Our solar awareness is integral to our arms, our fingers, our eyes, our nose, our every organ, and our four lower bodies. We have a memory body, a mental body, and a desire body, as well as the physical body. We suffer not only the anguish of physical pain, but also the anguish of emotional pain. Our physical organs can become ill because of the pain of the soul. There is more happening during gestation than the soul meshing with the physical body. The spirit, as well as the etheric, mental, and emotional bodies, are being brought back from all previous lifetimes. We have one etheric body that we have carried with us since the beginning, a mental body that consists of our mind and the accumulations of our reasonings in the mind of God, as well as in the lower octaves. We have a desire body containing all of the desires we have ever had, including the records of those that have been fulfilled. We are a fully integrated entity, a being of God. All we need when it comes time to return to Earth is a new physical body. And while that physical body is being formed, the three other bodies are meshing with it again. The Spirit of the Living God and the I Am Presence is also a part of every son and daughter of God, directly tied to that child from the moment of conception, when it is only called an embryo. Embryonic life contains the seed of the living God. When we speak of the Spirit of the Lord, it is the capital S, the I Am that I am, the Father, Mother, God. This is the God essence, or the God life of all of us. The spirit, with a lowercase s, of your life stream and mine, is defined as our animating principle, our energy, what kind of a person we are. Our spirit is the overriding vibration reflected in our character. We say of someone their spirit is laconic or feisty, or that individual has an evil spirit, or an honest heart, an honest spirit, and so forth. The spirit, then, of the individual is distinguished from the soul. The former being masculine, the latter feminine. So the spirit is also infused into the physical body, as the very blood cells are being formed. The spirit or essence is always in the blood of the individual, as well as in the entire body itself. The etheric body contains the record of your divine plan, the image of the Christ, in whose image you were made. The etheric body contains the memories and records of all that you have ever done in previous lifetimes. We know that our memory in this life defines our identity. Remove from the screen and from the memory bank of the computer all memories of anything we have ever done before this moment, and not one of us would know who we are. We are who we are by memory. But the memory we contain and the momentums in that memory contain all of the experiences that we have ever had since we first came forth from the heart of God. That memory is with the soul, integrating with the physical body in this 9-month period. Likewise, the mental body is the accumulation of the cognitive and reasoning mind, the rational thinking self. All that we have ever thought and reasoned and become because of our thoughts and reasonings, we bring with us in our mental body. It is there from the moment of conception. Through the entire process of gestation, this mind is meshing with the new physical body. It is part of the identity being formed and the identity that already is. For the child's psychology is molded while he is in the womb by his parents' psychology. And that becomes a part of the psychology that he brings with him from past lifetimes. What we need to understand is the selective process by Almighty God, by the mind of Christ, of the genetic code that will be ours for this lifetime. Through that genetic code and those genes, we are expressing a portion of the vast memory, mental, and desire bank that we bring with us. A slice of our life will become prominent in this incarnation. For our life is infinite, and this finite time and space world, this finite body, cannot contain the totality of our being. Therefore, you see the great causal body of yourself in the chart behind me, and you see those spheres of light that contain all good, all that is of high vibration, all that is constructive that you have ever done in all of your previous lifetimes. For the purposes of your divine plan and your karma in this life, you can access a portion of that causal body to accomplish certain things that are your assignment for this life. And so, just as you bring your memory and your mind with you, you bring your desires and your desire body. We have fulfilled and unfulfilled desires from previous lifetimes. We will have to deal with these. We will have to sort them out. We will have to admit the limits of our mortality. 70, which desires shall we fulfill in this lifetime? This we will learn to do under the guidance of teachers, parents, and our own communion with our own inner God. So we have to look at what we want to accomplish in life. We have to look at our unfulfilled goals, and we have to see, for instance, if there has been a sudden cutting off in the very midst of the very prime of life, of those things that we wanted to accomplish, maybe by untimely death or a violent crime. We may desire to come back and pick up the pieces as soon as possible, to be reunited with loved ones, to fulfill what we began. Many of us are here today because we have unfinished business. I feel that I have unfinished business. I have many things I want to do. And one of the most important things I want to do is to tell you and the world today about the soul in the womb and the tremendous opportunity to fulfill that fiery destiny that God has ordained for each one of us. So as the unborn child is developing and after birth continues to develop, that desire body integrating with the new physical body, with a new world and with a new opportunity, the focus of life's goals begins to sharpen and to take form. When we're little, sometimes we want to become a doctor or a nurse or a fireman or an Indian chief or a policeman. And as we grow a little older, we refine those goals in terms of priorities, necessities, economic, family responsibilities, and so forth. As these things are recognized to be there at birth, let us recognize that they are not only there at conception, but at levels of preconception, when we are preparing to take embodiment and when we are being instructed in schools of light, retreats of the ascended masters in the etheric octaves, preparing for that mission when we can gain many victories and perhaps conclude our reincarnations on earth. As a side note, I would also like to say that this teaching does not conflict with a teaching about the soul leaving the body at night to study in the etheric retreats. When the soul goes forth from the body at night, it actually leaves a portion of itself behind with the body. That is why when you are suddenly awakened, often you are not fully in your body, but you can accomplish certain tasks or respond to an emergency or take care of a child that is crying. You may not necessarily be fully back in your body. You may be continuing your experience in the inner retreats because a portion of yourself is fully integrated with that body. Now we come to another argument for abortion. That argument says that a fetus is not a human. It is a potential human. Take, for example, Dr. Jane Hodgson, an obstetrician who has supervised and or participated in 30,000 abortions in the last 20 years. This is what she says about her role as an abortionist. "I think I have done a humane service for lots of women in this world. I don't look upon it as killing, because I do not consider in the first place that the embryo or the fetus is a person." She says, "It is a potential person. Therefore, she is content to kill potential persons because they have not yet earned the status of personhood." The question is, do you or I have the right to snuff out life, burgeoning life, that has not only the potential to be God, but is already God from the moment of conception? Does the child in the womb have any less potential to be God than you or I? Each of us has the unlimited possibility to realize the seed of God, the seed of life itself, life with a capital L. Yes, we have the seed of our immortality from conception and prior to conception. We have always had that seed. This immortality is our goal and the reason God sent us forth into incarnation. We don't say to each other, "Well, I can kill you or you or you, because you're not a god yet. You're just a potential god." At what stage of physical spiritual evolution do we draw the line? Can we ever say that anyone is subject to termination because he has not realized his full human or divine potential? What's going on here anyway? Do we have to be a full-blown Buddha or a full-blown Christ to be guaranteed our constitutional right to life? Let's take a look at the question from the purely humanistic standpoint. Even if you take the view that man doesn't have a divine spark, he's of the race of Homo sapiens, one among another species. Surely we would have to consider that if we were to eliminate any segment of humanity or a single human being, that we would be eliminating a link in the genetic chain. This chain that could ultimately bring forth a Beethoven, a Dostoevsky, an Einstein, an Abraham Lincoln, a Jesus Christ. The geniuses that have enabled the human race to leap forward scientifically, culturally, and spiritually. And what about the common everyday people? They are the carriers of the genes of genius that one day shall appear. But we believe that we are more than human. We believe that we have a divine spark given to us by our Father, Mother, God. We believe that we are sons and daughters of God, of Elohim. Mother Mary settled the question with her statement dictated through me in New York on October 26, 1990. She said, "No matter what the argument, no matter what the evidence, life begins at conception. And I speak of the conception of the soul in the heart of the great central sun, of you and your twin flame in the beginning. Life on earth likewise begins at conception. And even at that moment does the spirit begin to weave itself as part of the fabric, even the warp and woof of that body. Therefore, beloved, woman has a right to bring forth that which is conceived by love and in love by God. May you know, beloved, that this issue, which has become such a controversy in this nation, may be dispensed with by the very simple teaching. Abortion in the physical sense is also abortion in the spiritual sense. And to abort the divine plan of a life, whether physically or spiritually, is a sin against the Holy Ghost. In conclusion, I would say the views on the soul, on the body, on reincarnation, or the views concerning the soul being formed at conception, are taught by those who are ignorant and who have not received the mysteries of God or the mysteries of life. They are the blind leaders of the blind. And these are they who do not even provide women with the essentials of the facts concerning life in the womb, and that this is a child from conception. Ignorance, therefore, in this dark age of the Kali Yuga is having its day, and we must seize the sword of Archangel Michael and plunge it into the very cause and core of that ignorance, that we might bring with enlightenment to fathers and mothers and all people the great joy of being co-creators with God. The abortion of the divine plan of a soul. The abortion of a soul is the abortion of her destiny and her divine plan. It is the abortion of an individual calling from God. For our Father, Mother, God chooses the very special moment in history for each soul to return to earth, to take part in the divine plan of the decades and the centuries. When we abort life in the womb, we are aborting the opportunity of a soul whose timetable has come to be on earth at that precise astrological moment. The timetables of the conception and birth of every child are directed by Almighty God, by the archangels and cosmic beings of light, and the specific ascended masters who are the sponsors of that soul, the godparents, if you will. These timetables are part of God's grand design of life. Think how wondrously you were made, how God cared for you personally, how your own father, mother ordained your conception, your parents, your life, your purpose, your reason for being, carefully oversaw the nurturing of you in the womb, and you were born at that precise moment. No one is an unwanted child. Though parents may think they don't want the child, it is the true godparents who have wanted you and ordained you. Therefore, I say to all, be healed of the burden that you may have been the unwanted child, for your Father, Mother, God loved you in the beginning, has loved you through the burdens of such associations, and will love you all the way through to your victory home to his heart. Not one birth has ever taken place upon this planet that was not sanctioned by Almighty God and the Holy Spirit. No matter how hard you may try to conceive a child, unless it is the will of God and the timing of God, that child will not be conceived. The moment of conception is the moment of the ordaining of life by the Holy Spirit. Even before a child is conceived in the womb, the divine plan of a soul has been worked out in intricate detail. The grand design of God is so exact that at the moment of conception, the genes in that tiny embryo are already suited to the specific soul who will inhabit it. Before conception ever takes place, a board of spiritual overseers called the karmic board, together with the Holy Christ self of the soul, determines when and where and under what circumstances the soul will embody. These circumstances are tailored to the soul's needs in order to give her the best opportunity to work out her karma. The law of karma is inseparable from life upon earth. It implies reincarnation, even as reincarnation implies karma. Karma, the karma each of us carries with us, contains positive and negative momentums. Momentums we have set in motion by our free will, by actions, by words, by deeds, by thoughts, by feelings, as well as by sins of omission, inaction, not speaking out when we should, not taking action, but simply sitting back and being an observer, taking life as a spectator sport. Karma is reaping what we have sown yesterday, 5 minutes ago, and 10,000 years ago. As God has ordained the cycles and laws of his universe, it works out that many of us do not reap in a given lifetime what we have sown in that life. We don't know if it will take 1,000 or 12,000 years for that energy, those actions, to come full circle to demand that we make them right. But God knows, and his law is unerring and unfailing and always just. And therefore, if we do the tasks of the day perform the services, and take our responsibilities each day of our life, doing all we can do to help others, as well as to inject into the society gifts we can give, something we can offer of our creation, from our profession, from our learning. That is sowing good karma as well as balancing bad karma. Free will, therefore, cannot be absolute or omnipotent, because in the exercise of free will, we have ordained what must come next in our life, whether blessing or bane, according to how we have sown. You would have to not be an observer of life at all to have failed to have seen that this law of karma is always acting in your life. So, as it is written in the New Testament, God is not mocked. This means that his law of karma will never be mocked. Paul also said that none shall escape. They shall not escape their karma. They shall not escape the law. God will not be mocked. Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. Because we wind up at the conclusion of a lifetime with many debts and the desire to pay them, God gives us in his mercy the opportunity to return and to make things right. This is a far better solution than Orthodox Christianity, which tells us heaven or hell are the only choices. Most of us are ready for neither and desire to finish up the Lord's business here on earth. Jesus had that great desiring. He said, I must work the works of him that sent me. The Father worketh hitherto, and I work. We sense ourselves as the extensions of God. The body of Israel in Jewish teaching is the extension of the action of the Divine Mother on earth. We must be about the business of our Father, Mother, God, and we must fulfill our divine plan. This is the inner sense of karma, and beyond karma, the fiery destiny of the soul, the desire to fulfill our reason for being. Every soul who is prepared to come into life is charged with that sense of going back to pick up the drop stitches, finish up that business, and set our house in order, and then give the world something of ourselves, that great creative gift, that gift of love and sweetness, of kindness, or some great monument of achievement. And so before conception, the parents of every child, whether they are aware of it or not, in their outer consciousness, have agreed at inner levels to receive that soul. If they have not agreed, they have been made aware that it is their karma to have that soul. Sometimes parents, seeing that this is a responsibility they must carry out, do not agree to sponsor the child because they are not willing to submit to the law of God. Often this is because their teachers, pastors, ministers, and rabbis have been wanting in the great knowledge of these cycles of life and have not been able to teach them, have not taught them that if they do not fulfill the calling to bear life now, that they will be in a sense aborting their life plan and its cycles. So in resisting that assignment, even though they may need to have that child, they both have karma with him or with her, they place themselves in a more difficult karma-making circumstance because sometime, somewhere, they will yet have to bear that child. When two people block their opportunity to balance karma by aborting a child they have conceived, they will find that they cannot go on with their own divine plan. And it is very difficult to come to the place once again where two individuals will be together and that soul will be available and blessed by God to take embodiment. So it is not only the child's opportunity for life and spiritual growth that they are denying, but it is their own soul's divine plan and opportunity for life and spiritual growth that they are denying. A denial of life on the one hand, does return as karma, the denial of life on the other. We lose something when we abort life in any way or circumstance, even if it is to crush another with words or with unkindness or meanness. I remember many years ago visiting my next door neighbor. We'd grown up together, known each other all our lives. She was married, doing very well financially. She and her husband had had 4 boys. And the husband was in the process of making the decision to be sterilized. I saw a beautiful girl, a child who was to be born through them in their auras. As I visited with them, I suggested very strongly that if they would have just one more child, they would have a girl and complete their family. They were adamant and were not to be convinced. He was sterilized, and they did not bring forth that child that they should have brought forth in this life. Interestingly enough, they both came from very large families. So I looked at this beautiful little girl some months later, and I realized that she would not be born to them in their present life. And I saw the lines of karma whereby that couple would have to reincarnate again in order to give birth to that child. This is why, under certain lines of planning and birth control methods, it is wise to respect the opportunity that God gives us to bear children and to rejoice in the opportunity of giving life to those from whom sometime, somewhere, we may have taken life. This is the great joy and purpose of marriage, of bringing forth children who can carry on in their mission, even as through them we are allowed to fulfill our mission. Children, of course, do not always represent karmic debts that we are paying off. But often, and more often, it is the case. Some parents who have already had children and have balanced the karma that they are intended to balance in this life through childbearing may then be chosen by God to bring forth children with whom they have no negative karma, but on whose behalf they are given the opportunity to bring them forth. And these may be highly gifted children who may make a great contribution to society by bringing back their past attainment with them. God has shown me that every child that is conceived has a divine plan and a divine design. Even if the do-gooders in society claim that the child is unwanted or handicapped and therefore should not be born into this world. The renowned pediatric surgeon and former U.S. Surgeon General, Dr. C. Everett Koop, says, "It has been my constant experience that disability and unhappiness do not necessarily go together. Some of the most unhappy children whom I have known have all of their physical and mental faculties. And on the other hand, some of the happiest youngsters have borne burdens which I myself would find very difficult to bear. Who are we to say that a life is not worthwhile? Only the soul herself can say. Helen Keller proved that life is worth living and fighting for. How can we ever forget the remarkable determination and the daring of the deaf, dumb, and blind girl who overcame the utter darkness of her childhood to become an exceptional author, educator, and lecturer? People who are born into abject poverty and the worst of circumstances often rise to become great leaders and prime movers of the destinies of nations. Look at President Abraham Lincoln, born to uneducated parents and raised in a log cabin in the backwoods of Kentucky. And the famous abolitionist leader, Frederick Douglass, born and raised as a lowly Negro slave. And the American inventor and technological genius, Thomas Edison. Did you know that he attended school for only 3 months of his life and was expelled by his schoolmaster as retarded. There is something higher than the body and higher than circumstance. It is the drive of the soul and the spirit that gives character and direction and impetus to an individual. We also have to remember that many people have serious karmas. They may have committed violent crimes in the past, child abuse, and so forth. Such individuals are required by the law of their own karma to embody in circumstances that are not ideal, because the purpose of karma is never to punish, but is to help us learn from our past mistakes. The only way we can learn from past mistakes is to go over them, to be in the same circumstance or a similar one where that is done to us that we have done to life. The hard knocks of life are sometimes what our souls need. The family and environment we are born into, and the friends, the foes, and the challenges we meet along life's way are all a part of the wondrous and intricate blueprint from the mind of God. This blueprint is given to us so that we can overcome all things through Christ, who strengthens us, and return home, a graduate of Earth's schoolroom in this life. God is teaching us through many ways, through experience, through karma. We cannot merely learn out of books. We are drawn from life, and to life we must go for some of our most essential lessons. Let us not resist those lessons or feel sorry for ourselves. Let us learn them well and become strong so we can help others. We find confirmation of these truths in the fascinating work of Dr. Helen Wambach. Her studies have given us a glimpse into the spiritual life of the unborn child, as well as the continuity of the soul. Dr. Wambach was a clinical psychologist and regression therapy expert who pioneered past life and prenatal research. She once said of her work, 90% of the people who come to me definitely flash on images from a past life. I am convinced that the time has come to study rigorously the plausibility of reincarnation. In one study, she asked 750 people under hypnosis questions about life before birth. She analyzed their answers in her book, Life Before Life. Although I believe that hypnosis can be dangerous under certain circumstances, and I do not recommend it as a tool in psychology, Dr. Wambach's findings are extremely interesting and worthy of study. For one thing, they reveal the soul's sense of the timetable of its mission. For example, many of her subjects knew they were born in the 20th century for a specific reason. Of those who answered yes to the question of whether or not they chose the 20th century to live their coming lifetime, the majority said they chose this time period because of its great potential for spiritual growth. You must understand that they chose to do what their counselors recommended that they do when they saw given to them and unfolded before them the karma of their previous lifetimes and the associations that they must meet again. 30% of her subjects knew they had to live during this time in order to be with certain people. Some stated that their purpose in this lifetime was to be with one or several other people they had known in past lives in order to work out their relationships. Others said they had come to fulfill a certain mission. Dr. Wambach observed that the largest group of the sample said that the purpose of this lifetime was to grow spiritually and to teach others. One of her subjects said, "Before my birth, there was a conference, and I had a feeling of deep love from one of my advisors. He talked of my learning to reach my life plan. When you asked about purpose, all I felt was a strong feeling of a plan." Her subjects agreed that others helped them in the process of choosing another lifetime. Of those who reported counselors before birth, 59% mentioned more than one counselor. We, of course, do have spiritual counselors who groom us for our soul's encounter with the challenge of our karma in our next life. Between embodiments and while in the womb, the soul is busy preparing for these challenges. She is being tutored at the soul level by spiritual beings on what is called the etheric plane. This plane of being is as real and concrete as the physical plane, but is experienced through the senses of the soul in a dimension and consciousness beyond physical awareness. The etheric plane is peopled by ascended masters, angels, and great beings of light. When souls of light are without a body between embodiments, they reside in this dimension of being. Here they are schooled in etheric retreats and universities of the ascended masters. While your physical body is in the sleep state, you also have the opportunity to travel in your finer bodies to the etheric plane to receive nightly lessons from your elder brothers and sisters, the ascended masters. You do not necessarily remember consciously these experiences, but they are real. Some people have glimpses of their experiences at inner levels through their soul memory or their dreams, when the door to realms of light, our real and eternal home, opens just a crack. Before coming into embodiment, each soul passes before the Lords of Karma to receive her karmic assignments for that life. These assignments are specific to each soul. They are carryovers from previous lives. We have many promises to keep and assignments to fulfill, and weeds to pull and flowers to plant. Dr. Wambach's study also reveals the sensitivity of the child in the womb. She reported that 86% of her subjects said they became aware of the feelings, emotions, and even thoughts of their mother before they were born. They were aware not only of their mother's feelings, but also of her interactions with their father. They could sense their mother's many different emotions, from fear and anger to peace and well-being. I myself had a recall of a previous life, and I recalled my experience in the womb before birth. I was being born through a very dominating mother who happened to be of a royal house of Europe, who totally dominated my father and put him down and did not give him his rightful place in the court. I grew to have contempt for this mother, for the way she treated my father while I was in her womb. This was an amazing recall for me because it formed my attitudes toward my parents in that life. There is no question that the child in the womb knows his mother, hears every word she says, and can become comforted or frightened by what he hears and senses. I was reminded of this in a tragic way when a woman once called me in my office for counseling. She said that one day during her pregnancy, she had become very angry with her husband. She flew into an intense and prolonged rage. She called to tell me that the next day she had had a miscarriage and that she knew deep within her soul that she had caused the miscarriage by her rage. The child had elected either not to be born through them or the energy was so intense that it actually killed the fetus. One of the most interesting conclusions of Dr. Wambach's research is that some of her subjects who were adopted children said they knew before they were born that they were going to be adopted. Dr. Wambach says some of them knew before they were born of the relationship they would have with the adoptive parents and felt that they would not be able to come to them as their own genetic child, but chose the method of adoption as a way to reach their parents. She concluded from her research that chance and accident apparently played no part in adoption. This puts a new light on the attitude among many people today that if you are pregnant and don't want to keep your child, you might as well abort it. Your karma may necessitate that you bear a certain child so he can get to his own real parents, who are not able to have children. And if it is not your karma, it is a service that you can perform for life, at the same time not making the negative karma of aborting a soul and a divine plan as well as a body. This is why we need to counsel young women and young men as well, who are fathers and mothers who are expecting, who may not want their children because they are unmarried. They may not want to carry them to term. We must encourage them to do so, to love and care for these mothers, especially when they are unwed. Teach them how to love their babies in the womb. Tell them the story of the life of the soul and the body in the womb. And then to give up their child for adoption if they have to, so that their child can be in their rightful karmic place and pursue their divine plan, and so that they will make good karma by carrying that child rather than negative karma in aborting it. All of us have a date, so to speak, with our karma. If we miss that date, then we miss our opportunity to pay off old debts that are owing certain individuals. And if we miss our cycle of opportunity, we may not get it again for a long, long time. Since the 1973 United States Supreme Court decision in Roe v. Wade legalizing abortion, over 25 million children have been aborted in the United States. These missing persons will not take their place as adults in the world scheme in the final decade of the 20th century, nor will those who might have been their offspring. The absence of these life streams in embodiment in this hour has compromised the divine plan for Earth. The consequences for all of us are serious. 25 million individuals did not contribute what God intended them to contribute to life on Earth in the decades of the 70s and the 80s. They did not grow up and marry and give life to other souls who were intended to learn from them, to be sponsored by them as their parents and teachers. Do you think that God only thinks of you when you are born? He is already thinking whose great-great-grandmother and great-great-grandfather you're going to be when you are yet in the womb. The plan of the mind of God is vast, a cosmic computer that none of us can even begin to comprehend. By playing God in aborting life, we are interfering with our evolutionary chain of life begetting life, life depending on life, helpless life depending upon those who are the strong. And with all the talk about the ecology of the planet, we should be concerned about the ecology of souls on the planet. There is a chemistry of certain souls who are meant to live together, evolve together, and experience life together. And they have a collective unconscious, and they respond together to the advancements of their time. Furthermore, the whole human race has a gene pool, and those genes are carefully calculated by God to be available for the incarnation of specific souls who have a specific mission, special souls, like you and me, and all who inhabit planet Earth today. All of us are special in the eyes of our Father, Mother, God. What some call the population explosion of the 20th century was ordained by God and sponsored by our teachers of the Aquarian Age, Saint Germain and his twin flame, Portia, for karmic reasons. Billions of souls need to be in embodiment together as we move from the Piscean Age to the Aquarian Age. For we are reaping karma, not only of the Piscean Age, but also of 25,800 years. 25,800 years is a cycle of 12 ages. Astrologically, it represents the time it takes the equinoxes to precess through one complete cycle of the zodiac. souls who should be accelerating in the winds of Aquarius and the violet flame of the Holy Spirit, souls who should be ushering in the Aquarian age, are simply not here. They are waiting in the wings when they should be star players on the stage of life. Those who should be in leadership roles in education, in the war on crime and drugs, are simply not here. They are not where they are supposed to be, leading America to the pinnacle of a golden age in the 20th and 21st centuries. O God, deliver us from the Death Rider. We are not going to right the wrong of abortion unless we act today to reverse the tide of the slaughter of the innocents. I call upon 25 million American couples to each have an extra one or two babies that you weren't planning on, to atone for the sins of our nation before it is too late. Yes, America, inconvenience yourself, for the trek upward is worth the inconvenience. We should all be on our knees before Almighty God, offering prayers of sacrifice as penance for the sins of the many. Father, forgive them, they know not what they do. Call upon the Lord to give you the opportunity to bring in souls who are key to the turning of worlds and to our civilization's fulfillment of our reason for being. America, we have to get these 25 million souls we have aborted into embodiment as fast as our legs can carry us. The stages of fetal development. Advances in technology now enable us to look directly into the womb. We can see what human life looks like in its earliest hours, days, and months. The time of possible conception by the female is limited to 1 day a month. Woman has 2 ovaries and 2 fallopian tubes. Each fallopian tube connects 1 of the ovaries to the uterus. The ovaries alternate in producing an egg. Each ovary produces 1 egg every other month. Each month, an egg or ovum enters 1 of the fallopian tubes. It has between 10 and 24 hours for fertilization to occur. If it is not fertilized in that time, it will disintegrate and be shed with the lining of the uterus in the next menstruation. The ovum is about 90,000 times larger than a sperm cell. About 250 million sperms start the race from the vagina to the uterus. They swim upstream almost in formation towards the waiting egg at a rate of about 3 inches an hour. It will thus take 2 hours to swim between 6 and 7 inches, the distance from the vagina to the egg. Of the hundreds of millions of entrants in this race, only about 100 reach the ovum. After reaching the ovum, the remaining sperms strive to penetrate the egg. As soon as one is proclaimed the winner, a change in the chemical composition of the outer wall of the ovum causes it to shut tight, preventing any other contestants from entering. The first week of life. The sperm cell that has entered the ovum combines its nucleus with that of the ovum to become a single cell. The uniting of the two nuclei is the moment of conception. The resulting single nucleus contains 46 chromosomes, 23 chromosomes from each parent. These chromosomes contain the genes that are the complete biological blueprint for a new individual. About 12 hours after the union of the nuclei, the new cell begins to divide and multiply. In about another 12 hours, the two cells will divide again and then again. They have begun a sequence that will culminate in a fetus that contains millions upon millions of cells. As it continues to divide, the ovum starts the 4-day journey down the fallopian tube towards the uterus. The 3-day-old cell cluster is called a marula, which is Latin for mulberry. By the 4th day, the cells will have increased to more than 100 and formed into a hollow ball called a blastocyst. The word blastocyst comes from the Greek blastos, meaning sprout, and cyst, meaning pouch. A sprout pouch. The blastocyst implants itself in the wall of the uterus about 7 to 9 days after conception. The mother's body doesn't even know that this new life exists. The embryo has to tell the mother that it exists by producing a hormone. This hormone tells the ovaries to make another hormone, progesterone. The progesterone warns the pituitary gland that the mother is now pregnant and should stop the shedding of the uterine lining in menstruation. A tiny embryo that is much smaller than an apple seed is now directing the mother's body. Since the embryo is genetically different from the mother's immune system marshals to destroy it. But the embryo releases other chemicals which act to turn off the mother's immune system within the uterus. In the 2nd week of life, the cells are beginning to differentiate to perform specialized tasks. One group of cells becomes the amnion, a protective sac that will keep the embryo in a fluid environment. Another becomes the yolk sac, which will produce the blood cells needed by the developing embryo. A portion of the yolk sac will form the gut. A 3rd group of cells will form the placenta. The placenta brings the baby's blood into contact with the mother's bloodstream so that it can receive oxygen and food and dispose of waste products. The umbilical cord, made up of two arteries and one vein, connects the embryo to the placenta. The mother may now sense that she is pregnant and experience some morning sickness. The third week of life marks the beginning of the formation of the nervous system. The embryo is now growing so rapidly that it doubles in size almost daily. It also changes shape dramatically from round to elongated. There is a deep groove along the length of the embryo. The groove folds into a tube that will house the spinal cord, and then the top of the tube enlarges to become the brain. The nervous system is the first of the body systems to develop. It will influence the growth of all the other organs in the future development of the fetus. By the 18th day after fertilization, a tiny primitive heart has formed. Between the 18th and the 25th day, the heart will begin to beat, later increasing in frequency to up to 100,000 times each day. At the time the heart begins beating, the mother is not even sure she is pregnant. The baby's heart beats much faster than its mother's. It beats approximately 140 times per minute. The average adult heartbeat is 70 times per minute. In the 1980s, ultrasound enabled us to see live footage of an embryo as early as the fourth week. At the same time as the heart and the nervous system are forming, cells deep within the embryo are also differentiating into muscles, blood vessels, bones, and organs. A simple liver is forming, along with the start of the intestinal tract and kidneys. In the fourth week of life, the embryo is 1/5 of an inch long, yet that is 10,000 times larger than the fertilized egg. By 5 weeks, it will reach 1/3 of an inch. During the fourth week, the mouth and body cavity develop. Early eyes begin to form along with the other sense organs, the nose and ears. Tiny limb buds sprout. The head and neck make up half of the total size of the embryo. A small tail reaches its maximum length. It will disappear in the following week. In the fifth week, we see an embryo at 5 weeks on this slide. During the fifth week, the head straightens up, the eye sockets darken as pigment is produced around the 35th day. The differentiation of the brain has advanced to the extent that the cerebral cortex is clearly visible. At approximately 40 days, brain waves can be detected and recorded. The fetus can move, although the mother cannot feel the movement. This is a slide of a 6-week fetus. During the 6th week of life, the arms and legs continue to take shape. The hands become web-like. A lens, a cornea, and iris develop in each eye. The heart shows through the chest and is red in color. The liver is beginning to take over the function of producing blood cells from the yolk sac. The brain is easily visible since the bones have not yet formed in the skull. Facial features begin to develop. In the 7th week of life, the embryo is recognizably human. Eyes, ears, nose, lips, and tongue are formed. At this time, more than 100,000 new nerve cells are created every minute. The embryo is completing the formation of all 40 muscle sets, which will enable it to move spontaneously. In the completed skeleton, bone begins to replace cartilage. The jaw forms. Buds of milk teeth are nested in the gums. At 8 weeks, the embryo has grown to 1 inch or more in length. He now looks like a tiny person. He weighs about 1/30 of an ounce. All the internal organs are formed. The future developments until birth will be those of size and perfection of detail. At 2 months of life, your baby has all that he will have for the rest of his life. think how important your diet is, your spiritual life, your attitude, the harmony of your being. All of this has affected the foundations of your baby. His matrix, his design is sealed at 8 weeks. Now the embryo is called a fetus, which is Latin for young one or offspring. At 2 months, the fetus can move his arms and legs and swim in his watery world. Some little ones have been recorded turning complete flips in less than 2 seconds. There are 1.6 million abortions performed annually in America. 51% of them are performed before the 8th week. That's 816,000 abortions before the 8th week. Now we see the third month of life, 9 to 12 weeks. This is a slide of a 12-week fetus. During the third month of life, the fetus will grow to a length of 2 to 3 inches and a weight of about an ounce. The womb has now doubled in size, and the tiny child uses it for vigorous activity. Dr. Roberts Rue, an experimental embryologist, writes, "Now when the brain signals, the muscles respond and the fetus begins to kick, turn its feet, and curl its toes. Its delicate arm bends at the wrist and elbow, and its tiny hand forms a fist. The massive head atop the puny body pivots slightly on its stumpy neck. The face with its sealed shut eyes squints, frowns, purses its lips, and opens its mouth. The fetus has begun to breathe the amniotic fluid in order to exercise its respiratory system. He also drinks the amniotic fluid and begins to urinate. His eyelids have now fused together to protect the eyes. They will open again at the 7th month. The fetus alternately sleeps and wakes. His whole body is sensitive to touch. He has 10 fingers and toes and his own unique set of fingerprints." This slide shows the feet and toes of a 10-week-old fetus.